Can I make a game in C++ entirely on the stack? This means I won't call new, I won't call malloc, including other libraries or language features that might allocate memory. And I'm not going to be lazy and make snake or something boring like that. No, no. I'm going to make a 3D game from scratch without OpenGL. And the game will entirely run on the stack. Will I succeed in this challenge? Or will the stack fill up before I can finish the game? And while I'm setting up the project, you are probably asking, why would I do this? Well, you see, whenever I talk to beginners, the number one mistake I see is them allocating too many useless things on the heap, when instead, they should just keep most of the things on the stack. More on this later, but most of them are afraid of filling up the stack by using too many big classes. But that's not true, and that's why I'm making this video, to show you that the stack is much bigger than you think, and also because it's a very interesting challenge that would test my low-level knowledge. Let's lay some basic rules. The stack is 1 MB block of memory that is used to store your variables and function calls. For bigger memory needs, you usually use what is called a heap memory, that gives you access to almost your entire RAM. But for this project, 1 MB is all that I get. No heap means not calling new, and also, no external library that allocates memory. And I won't use OpenGL either, because it will allocate memory on the GPU, making this challenge way too easy. So I have to write my own software 3D renderer on the stack. I can't risk using GLFW either to open a window, because that will also probably allocate memory on the heap. So I'll have to open my own window using the Windows API and place pixels inside it. But before we do anything, because we are very limited in memory usage, we need to measure it at all times. The stack size is 1 MB. And with the help of ChatGPT, I implemented this function that prints the current stack usage. And it should come as no surprise that an empty program doesn't even use 1% of it. But in the future, we will be at all times very close to filling it and failing this challenge. In fact, we will actually fill it right now with the first task, opening a window. I know how to use Windows API to open a window and draw pixel by pixel. I even have an entire tutorial series dedicated to that. It's not even difficult. I set some flags for the window, I open it, and I handle events. And to display stuff on the screen, I create a big buffer of pixels that will live on the stack that I can simply write into. And then, those pixels will be... Well, it seems like the challenge ended before it even started. Here is the problem. If the screen has a size of, let's say, 600 by 700 pixels, and we need 4 bytes per pixel, that means almost 2 megabytes, which is double our entire memory budget. Now, there is a quick way to fix this. I could just place this memory buffer in the global memory region, which is not on the stack, nor on the heap, but that's basically cheating, and it would make the challenge way too easy. I could easily reserve like 1 GB of memory like this, and call it a day, but that's not what you came here for. Your boy is not taking any shortcuts. This game will live entirely on the stack, so subscribe if you appreciate my effort. Initially, I felt lost for a moment. I tried making the screen smaller, but a 500 by 300 pixel screen is way too small, while still occupying half my stack size. If only I could make the screen bigger, while keeping the same amount of pixels. Wait, say that again. It turns out I can do exactly that. I made the pixel 2 times bigger, giving me a decent window size, while using only this much memory in reality. And we can do even more things. Usually, one pixel is stored in 32 bits, 8 for red, 8 for green, 8 for blue, and 8 more, used for alpha, or simply unused. We can instead store one pixel in 16 bits, like so. 5 bits for blue, 6 bits for green, and 5 bits for red. Windows already knows how to read this kind of pixels. We just need to supply it a buffer, and that's it. With all of this in place, we get a decent sized window, while only using 28% of our memory budget. Now, having way less bits to store a pixel does mean we have less colors to display, but I will use that to my advantage later. Just wait and you'll see. This is a good start, but how do we get from something like this to a 3D game without using OpenGL? Well, we have to write our own 3D renderer. Unfortunately, I wrote the tutorial just for that. What you see here is only 500 lines of code, and if we get lucky, we won't need to optimize it too much for it to run well. I actually followed this tutorial and wrote the code myself a long time ago. So I took the code and pasted it into my project, and it worked almost immediately. I have to fix some bugs now, but graphics programming is actually not that hard once you get past the very first chapters. There are many new concepts that you need to put together, but after that, things are easy. So if you want to start OpenGL, to eventually make your own 3D engine, check out my OpenGL fail-proof course for beginners. And use this coupon to get 50% off, but it will expire in 5 days, so make sure you hurry. And remember I said fewer bits per color means fewer colors that I can display? Well, this gave the game a retro look, and reminded me of some horror games that have this aesthetic. So I decided to also make a horror game, and what better horror game than Slenderman? So that's what we are going to do moving forward. But right now, This 3D renderer here does allocate memory on the heap, so my plan is, now that I know it is working, to slowly work on it and replace all the allocations with stack-based operations. Instead of using vectors, for example, I will replace them with static arrays and so on. So that's what I worked on next, but I quickly realized that wasn't going to work. The model loading code uses a lot of vectors, both internally and to store the models, and replacing all of them would take me way too long. So I came up with an even better solution. I will overload the global new operator to use the stack. This means every time I use a vector in my project, it will actually use the stack instead of the heap. And not only that, but this also means that even if I accidentally use a C++ feature that I don't know it allocates memory, it will still use the stack instead of the heap. But this is not straightforward. First of all, I will create a big memory pool on the stack, making sure I give it enough memory, but not more than my maximum 1 MB budget. Then, I will use a custom memory allocator that I made some time ago, and it will use the stack memory to work with. I have to be careful though with creating global objects, because those are created before I initialize the allocator. So, creating a model object globally will instantiate a vector that will allocate memory that will use this memory pool before it was ever initialized. So that crashes my program. No problem, I will just slap an optional on top of this and no one will ever know. With that, we have spent most of our entire stack budget, but most of it is used for this custom allocator, where I load 3D models and I printed some memory metrics, and it turns out we still have plenty more memory to go. And that's perfect, because I have one more problem to solve. In order to display 3D models properly, I also need what is called a depth buffer. That basically means, for each pixel, I need to store its distance from the camera, so that when I want to draw a new object, I can determine which pixels are behind and which are in front. I will use 16 more bits per pixel for the depth buffer, and with some crashing and careful tweaking, we filled almost our entire memory budget, letting just 4% more unused for the actual things the stack is supposed to do, like variables. Then, I stumbled on this bug, where for some reason, some part of the world doesn't get rendered. This looked to me like a memory corruption problem, and given that we are literally using all of it, I thought this is our program screaming for help from his hospital bed. But fortunately, that wasn't the case. I did some Stalin debugging and found a problem. Basically, Stalin debugging means you just remove lines of code until you find where the problem is. And in my case, it had something to do with the depth buffer. Check this video if you want to learn more debugging tips like this. And now I can make some simple trees on the ground and place them down. And I even added the dithering effect to lean even more into that horror game aesthetic. Now I just have to make sure Slenderman doesn't find me. Ah! So the takeaway from this video is not to never use the heap, but rather use it only if you need to. Making memory allocations everywhere and using too many references instead of just getting the data every time can cause you lots of problems in terms of safety, correctness, maintainability, and speed. So, unless you have a reason for allocating memory on the heap, like your object is extremely big like this, or you don't really know the size in advance, don't allocate things on the heap. Replace this with this. And also, don't return things from a function like this. Return it inside a smart container, or request the user to pass you a buffer with a side instead. And if you want more memory management tips, check out this video to never have memory leaks again. See you!